Good afternoon, everybody. Good afternoon. You find me huddling under a variable bush willow here on the western fringes of the Greater Kruger National Park. This, of course, is what most of the animals are going to be doing today, simply because it is raining and it is windy and it is thoroughly unpleasant to be out in the elements. If you happen to be unprotected, as I am, well, I am protected, of course, by a sophisticated array of outdoor clothing. But if you don't have that, then your only course of action is to seek shelter underneath a bush like I'm doing here. I must tell you that I'm entirely sheltered from the wind here. Even my little plover-like legs are feeling warmer under this tree than they might otherwise. There is no rain falling upon my head, and that, everybody, is how it would be if you were an animal living in the Greater Kruger National Park, where you find yourself on a very live afternoon sunset. No, afternoon, yes, safari. My name is James Henry. On camera we have Brian Joubert, dressed up in how many jackets today, Brian?
Three
jackets today. It's a fairly unpleasant 17, blustery 17 degrees Celsius, which, if I'm not mistaken, works out at, I've completely forgotten, something around 64 degrees Fahrenheit, I think. So for us, that's freezing out here because it never gets cold here normally. And that's the state of affairs. In the final control, on the directing, we have Kirsten. She is being ably assisted by Rebecca. And on the other vehicle, the diminutive Jamie Patterson is driving around and will be presenting to you and filmed by Jandre the Foot Gerding. Welcome to it. I'm going to continue driving down the road here. And while I do that, it is important for me to tell you, of course, if you happen to be a new viewer, first of all, that you are extremely welcome. And secondly, if you are a new viewer or if you are one of our regular viewers, please do talk to us. It is quite likely going to be a quiet drive given the nature of the weather. So talk to us and let's have a conversation about Africa or South Africa or wildlife or conservation or anything sort of along those lines, anything vaguely attached to those sorts of things, we'll chat about them. Talk to us on Twitter, hashtag Safari Live, questions at wildearth.tv if you're on the email, or otherwise you can talk to us on the YouTube chat stream. There, I did it, Brian, I told you I would one day. And and we'll have a conversation about what's happening out here. You can see the trees moving all around us. I've got my beanie hat on, covering my rapidly balding head. I've had to put my new cap away because the sun has disappeared. Now, this is not a particularly sad thing out here, of course, because we see the sun for most of the year. So it's actually quite exciting when the weather turns like this every so often. We don't get quite the beautiful sunrises and sunsets that we would otherwise, but it is still very nice. And I must just say a big thank you to all of you for your kind welcomes of Sam Chevalier, our new presenter. He's doing a fine job. It's wonderful having him along, and we're so pleased that all of you seem to enjoy him so much. So thank you very much for that. Our plan this afternoon is going to be to head down towards the south of the reserve. Today, Brent Leo Smith and Brian managed to find Tingana and Tundi. They are still mating. I thought they'd finished. And so that's what we're going to try and find. Jamie's kind of heading down in the same direction, but further to the east of us. And she will attempt. We're both going to try and see if we can't find those two leopards. Also, Brent reckoned that the kill that they were eating was lifted off Karula. So maybe she's around as well, although with her little ones, I suspect quite strongly that she will be deep within some cover, possibly in the culvert or cave, wherever she's got those little cubs stashed, to stay away from this fairly inclement weather. A thick Scotch mist blowing in from the southeast. That's the direction that we're heading in right now. And if Brian tilts the camera up slightly like he's doing, you can see, well, first of all, you can see rain on the lens, which is unavoidable. And then you can also see the clouds kind of moving in from the southeast there. That's Brian cleaning the lens. Well done, Brian. Stoic fellow. And that's the story of the afternoon. So let's go across to Jamie, get an update from her and what she's doing, and I will see you hopefully with some good news.
Good afternoon and welcome to the Sunset Safari.
Although, as you can see, and I'm sure as James has discussed, the prospect of an actual visible sunset seems relatively unlikely at this stage. The wind is howling as this cold front moves across our skies. And we are currently on our way to see if we can follow up on where Tingana and Tundi were last seen this morning with Brent. I'm thinking that in cold weather like this, there is a good chance that they have moved somewhere to find shelter from the wind, possibly into a drainage line might be my guess. But you never know, we're on our way, we're very close to where Brent gave you the directions to that sighting. Let's go and investigate, see if they're still there, whilst the wind attempts to rip my rain covers away from poor old Wendy. Now, I believe he said best approach was just by this little pan, just close to this little pan that's on our left. I see tracks. Let's go and see if those leopards are still about. No, I don't see tracks, actually. So it was behind the quarry. Must be somewhere here. Jandre giving the lens a good wipe. It is here. Of course, with all of this, I wouldn't know if I'd call it rain, certainly drizzle. It's quite difficult to actually pick up on exactly where the vehicle tracks have gone off-road to where these leopards were. Ah, there we go. We are on the right track. Now it's important, one of the things that we really do focus on doing when we approach a sighting like this is to try and use exactly the same road in and out. And that way we just minimize the impact that we have on the bushveld itself. Because of course off-roading does have a certain impact on it. That's Gowrie Main. Almost. I managed to find us a road back to Gowrie Main, but that isn't where I wanted to be. Brent said it was behind the quarry where they get dig through and get sand and so on for the road network. So this must be the right approach. This weather has come as such a surprise, this autumnal shift. And I know that we are, of course, all very grateful for the rain. But I must confess, I'm wearing 4 layers, and I'm still freezing. We've lost our ability to deal with cold during our long, hot summer. It was somewhere here. See the vehicle tracks? And I think they must have been just here. Seek them here, we seek them there. I don't see any of them anywhere. But that it hasn't come as that much of a surprise. I did expect them to have moved somewhere more comfortable. And John, you were wondering if the influx of animals that we've had in the Sabi Sands, particularly elephants, would be due to the drought in Kruger. And yes, that's exactly what it would be due to. John, there, directly to the east of us, when I went to visit Kruger, it's the situation's changed slightly now, but when I went to go and visit Kruger, the water holes were completely dried up. It was incredible, there was very, very little food around them. That area had just been so heavily grazed that there wasn't much in the way of food for the animals to eat. And so they have come through towards the Sabi Sands, where there's been slightly less overgrazing or overutilization of the bush, and also where there are pumped water holes, which of course really helps. I'm just trying to make sure I stay on this track that has been made for me by Brent and other vehicles. There we go. Apparently, The sighting that you enjoyed this morning was an incredible one, with Tundi moving up into the tree, Tingana also, of course, managing to find a kill that Brent suspects was initially or originally Karula's. His explanation or his reason for guessing that was that he had a set of tracks for a female moving on her own. Opposite direction of where Tundi and Tingana's tracks came through. It's very common for something like that to occur, for a female to lose her kill to another leopard, and she won't want to have stuck around with Tundi in her, right in the center and the heart of her territory. But that being said, that doesn't mean she might not still be in the area as well. We know that Karula, and it's very common with female leopards, when a female enters their territory with a male, because the female will essentially... Ah! Very well done, Jandre. Awesome spotting. Yay! Concentrating so hard on the vehicle. I can see him as well, by the way. There we go. Looking very peaceful and relaxed. The gorgeous Tundi, well spotted, Jandre. Well spotted, haha. Well spotted, like she's well spotted. Because that's stretching it a little bit, isn't it? I'm so sorry. And then Tingana looking at us in the back. Keeping a very respectful distance from her. Aww. And actually, I heard her purring there for a second. As she rubs her head on the log, using it as a scratching post. Hello, gorgeous. Isn't it incredible how much she looks like her sister? Big, big yawny, tired girl. So yes, her twin sister, Shadow, shares the territory on the western side of their mother's territory. They're the two girls, the oldest of Karula's progeny. She's having such a good head scratch there. But I said that she looks like her sister, and she really, really does. Oh. Look at that white belly. Are you waking up? Or are you finding a more comfortable spot? So cutesy. She's purring. Can you hear that, Jandre? I don't know if you can. Ah. That's what she's doing. She's doing her seduction dance as Tingana looks on. I'm just going to be quiet so we can hear the sound she's making. Too windy. What are you doing, you crazy girl? He's not that way. He's over there. I don't think he's terribly sold on your dance routine. I've never seen a leopard look more unimpressed. Come on, Tingana. Here we go. This is incredible. I've seen a leopard seduction dance before, but I've never seen it like this, with her dashing up and about and around and around. And now she's rubbing her head in the bush. All the while with these low, intense purring sounds. I'm giving her plenty of space for now. Nope, off we go again. I wonder if she's got into some catnip. It sort of looks like it. She is essentially trying to attract his attention and seduce him. She's not been terribly successful. I'm going to reposition slightly. Now, as I said, I'm going to give her plenty of space because she has been known to be quite stressed. I want to give her plenty of space to continue this dance routine. Chandra, here you are, you can see him. Let me go forward a bit further. In this chilly weather, okay, let's stick with a view of her for now. Continuing her mad dance moves. Cat in Tampa, in this chilly weather, you've said you know this is a silly question. But do leopards get their winter coats? And it's not a silly question at all. It's a perfectly logical question. And the answer is no, not really, just because it doesn't get that cold in the low veld. The lowest it will really get is about 0 degrees centigrade, so close to 32 degrees Fahrenheit, not quite cold enough for them to really need a thick winter coat, like, for example, certain foxes and bears do. This is so interesting. Obviously the end of her, we're coming to the end of her mating cycle, her estrus cycle. Oh, there's a perfect scratching post. Hey, gorgeous. Absolutely stunning. I do just need to get onto the game drive comms for 1 second. Afternoon stations, I've got the Fugger Bugatti Ingwe on the northern side of the quarry where they were left this morning. She's really working so hard to get his attention. That happened so quickly. But she managed. She managed eventually. Hello, boy. You couldn't look more unimpressed with life if you tried. There she is, moving at the back. Now, apparently this morning he was desperately looking for the meal that he could smell. But he eventually managed to find it and snack on the dacre, so he's looking much more full-bellied than he was earlier. Ooh, I think she's gonna try again. She's not a happy kitty. That purring growl. She's restless, she's pacing. I think she's gonna go again. For those of you who are joining us for the first time, maybe you've never seen mating leopards before, this looks like an incredibly aggressive process, and in fact it is. And the reason that he growls at her like that and she snarls at him like that is because he's learned that the female reacts that way to his attentions, and she is responding to the pain that is caused by his barbed penis. So the mating process is actually slightly painful for the female, and it causes those growls and snarls as she turns around, and very often as soon as the male pulls away, she turns around and swats him in the face. And he actually grabs her by the back of the neck to stop her doing that during the mating process. But I love moments like this because you really get to see the size difference between a male and a female leopard. It is particularly pronounced, and of course in Ghana, the male that's in front of us is a very big boy. He's an exceptionally large leopard with his dewlap, the flap of skin hanging in front of his neck. Is it my imagination, or does he look as though he's walking with a slight discomfort? He's limping quite... He's actually limping quite badly. Not limping, he just looks stiff and uncomfortable. Might be an old injury that's playing up in the cold weather. As it does in humans, tends to make all of those niggles a little bit more uncomfortable. She's going again, you know. Amazing. What's that? 3 times in 5 minutes? Very cross with him. It's the other reason why I'm giving her plenty of space as well, is that Tundi in particular shows a slight, or a very clear discomfort when she's been mating. Well, I've only ever seen her mating with Tingana. I assume it applies to all mating processes, but she gets a little bit more uncomfortable with the vehicle. And she very often turns her head and snarls at you in post-coital aggression, which I've seen her snarl at a tree before as well. And at one very memorable occasion, she turned around and snarled at a blade of grass that had caught the wrong side of her temper after mating with Tingana. Hence the space we've given her. She's going again. Well, she was thinking about it. Oh, no. She's had it. She's off. Rocky night. Well, we've now watched Tundi mating with Tingana on 3 separate occasions. Three separate estrus cycles. So obviously we know that she's not pregnant now. She's certainly doing a very good job at working at it. This is now go number 4. Isn't it fascinating? The biology of this whole process is so interesting. She's compelled to want to mate with him. And yet you can see that it's clearly not a process she enjoys. And certainly not something he enjoys. And yet that is what nature has brought them to do. And as she disappears behind the bush, I'm going to wait to see which direction she decides to go in. In the meantime, let's cross over to James, who has a bird hiding behind a bush.
There are some very, very cross plovers here, everybody, or lapwings, as they're now called. 2 crowned lapwings, and they are cross, Brian, because there are their eggies, just next to the road. Profoundly silly place to put them. But look how brilliantly camouflaged they are. As Brian zooms out, they become utterly invisible. These birds wouldn't normally be anywhere like this close to the vehicle, but they are only about, about 1.5 meters, about 5 feet from the vehicle now. And it's simply because they're trying to get us to go away, which we will shortly. One of them actually dive-bombed the car just before we came to see you. This will be Mummy and Daddy lapwing fairly soon. I was trying to sort of translate what they're saying to each other, but I couldn't get any sounds all the same to me. Wonderful sighting. All right, let's leave them. They're very depressed. Or distressed, sorry. I'm just going to drive slowly away and see if one of them doesn't go to the nest to sit on it. No. Okay. Let's go back to the... Sorry, Kirsten, you're going to have to go again with that. I don't know if we're going back to the leopards. Ah, let's go back to the leopards.
This has been absolutely fascinating. She's come in for a fifth attempt, which he has ignored. And she's bounding up and down the termite mound, trying to get his attention. He really isn't all that interested. She's just disappeared over the back. But I'm not going to reposition to see her because she's going to come to him. So we'll just make sure that we stay with him in view, and then we'll be able to pick the right spot to watch this entire process play out. Oh, really nice and comfortable there on a termite mound. Here she comes. Oh, no, don't go that side, girl. Oh, he really doesn't want to. Oh, she's at the bottom there. Flops onto her side is part of a continuing lordosis reflex. It is thought to help with fertilization. Now, if this mating is successful, Rocky Knight, you were wondering how long will it be until we know. We will know if she's not pregnant, if she comes back into estrus and is mating again in the next few weeks. But at the same time, we won't know if she's pregnant until right towards the end of her pregnancy, when she starts to show. And she rolls around on her back with her feet in the air like a kitten. It's such an interesting process. Tingana definitely walking as though he's a little bit sore. Whether that's from his current activities or from her reaction to the current activities, I'm not 100% sure. That's five times in, what's that been, 10 minutes. And they're coming right towards the end of the estrus cycle. It's also because it's cooler today. So they are not expending as much energy keeping cool. And they can use it for other things, including their current occupation. Where's she gone?
Just to the right of him.
She's just to the right of him. Thank you. Oh, yes. Rocky Knight will only really know in the last sort of two-ish weeks of her pregnancy, when her nipples start to swell and you really start to see the females carrying the weight to the sort of the bottom part of their stomach between their back legs. And that's the sign of it. Oh, she's coming again. Heads up, Tingana. Your lady wants more attention. She's such a pretty dark female. No, don't go there, girl. You can hear him going, okay, if you insist. Six, is that six or seven? I've actually almost lost count. Six in the last 10 minutes. And I'm sure that, well, I really hope that that will result in what she's looking for. Oh, quick snarl at each other. This is entirely speculation, but I also feel as though leopards, when they come together to mate, actually resent the loss of their solitary day-to-day existence, especially the males. I think they get very uncomfortable having constant company. There are cats that revel in being alone and secretive, and this whole process goes against their, not their natural instinct, obviously it's part of their natural instinct, but this whole process goes against their image. She's all muddy as well. you'll find that if this mating is successful in the next 3 or so months, usually about between 95 to 100 days that it takes for their gestation period, depending on the area and depending on the individual female. Off limps, poor Tingana. I think I do actually feel sorry for him. He's looking distinctly pained. Yes, we've got a 3-month waiting period in which we will have to wait and see if Tundi is pregnant. But then, as I said, if we see her mating again in the next few weeks, then we'll know that this particular mating wasn't successful. Gold, as we watch Tundi put on her seductive act again, and actually scratching her head at the same time. The reason why they need this repeated mating, and the reason why his penis is barbed and that causes the aggression, is yes, cats, the big cats, are induced ovulators just as domestic cats are, which means they need repeated stimulation before they actually ovulate. So whilst they come into estrus and are ready to mate, they need that stimulation before they will actually be able to be fertilized. And that's nature's way of adapting and allowing the biggest male in the area the opportunity to pass on his genes. So the healthiest, best father will be have the opportunity to come and fight off another male and actually get to the attentions of the female. Oh, oh! Bottom to the face.
Afternoon, mobile station. Do you have a please?
He looked back at us almost as if to say, can you believe it? I can't take much more of this. And then she goes to rub the back of her neck. And I think she's actually scratching there because she's a bit sore.
Okay.
Where his teeth have grabbed her. And there he goes, off he goes. Looking incredibly sorry for himself. To find another spot where he can try and be free of her intentions. Attentions. Afternoon stations, these two iwi are now slowly mobile to the west, just north of the quarry.
Thanks very much. We'll make our way, that's fine. Just
217
now.
Copy. Best approach is probably going to be from Shabam Road, just on the off-road tracks. They're on the off-road tracks at the moment. Just letting the other guides know that the leopards are still in the area and that we will be staying in them. I'm also telling them that the animals are moving because it's a good way for them to judge and to plan their game drive. Because there's always a chance when a leopard moves, where has he gone now? That you could lose them.
Okay.
Just like I've not lost her, I still can see her, but I can't see him at all. And he's the one we want to stay with because she will go to him. Okay, let's just go around quickly. Sorry, Jandre. Tundi again. She was here 2 seconds ago. You were wondering if she's ever... they're hidden behind this bush. Valeria, sorry. Back to what you were asking about, whether or not Tundi's ever raised cubs before. I'm going to try get a good visual of them. It might be a bit tricky for now until they get up and move again. Yes, as far as I know, she has. From what I understand, she has a 2-year-old daughter, but I don't know anything about her, I'm afraid. I've never seen her. I believe she might be around Marla Marla, but that is, I haven't managed to get the absolute clarification of that from the other guides. So yes, she has successfully raised a set of cubs before, at least one cub. I don't know much more about her background, and I'd be really happy if a lot of our regular viewers keep excellent records of the of Karula's family lines, of the various leopards of the Sabi Sands. And so maybe one of you out there, if you could let me know if she has any more cubs that maybe I haven't heard about that she's raised to adulthood, or whether or not it is just the one female. And of course, you can always send those through to hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or you can email through to questions@wildearth.tv. As poor Tingana limps off. Has he gone back to... I think he might have gone back to that Dacre kill, actually. Try and reposition. It's a bit tricky here, although he's very close to the road. How's your view of him from there, Jandre? Can you see him? I just don't want to put us in a position where we can't get around if they do start to mate. Tingana feeling a little bit sorry for himself after so many days of mating with Tandi, and it looks as though she is about to go back to him. However, James has got quite an unusual sight for the middle of the day. It seems as though he's found a hippo out of water.
So this is quite unusual. It's a hippopotamus, obviously. It couldn't really be anything else standing morosely like it is there. But what is unusual about it is that it is out of the water in the middle of the day. Now, I suppose it could be considered not uncommon for a hippo to be out of the water when the weather is as foul as it is today. But it's still a sight you very seldom see other than at a night. And he does seem to be doing a little bit of grazing. But hippos always give me the impression that they are A, slightly gormless, and B, slightly angry. Now, as we all know, you don't want... That's a sort of dangerous combination. Stupidity combined with a slight depression and general anger with the world. And so one must keep one's distance, especially if one happens to be on foot. If I saw that on foot, I would be walking the other way at an enormous speed, possibly running. They don't like to see people on foot. They're extremely easily threatened. Let's see if we can go and get another view there. But it's really quite special to see them out the water because you can see them move, you can see the way they walk. They're going to end up in this dam. You can see the way they walk, you can see their feet, you can see how they operate, which we so seldom are able to do because they're normally so deep in the water. I believe those leopards have been highly enthusiastic about each other. Can you see it, Brian? Straight through there. Shall we go? Say when?
He's behind that dead monitor.
Let's do a little foray off-road. I think he'll probably run away, though. We haven't had too much road at these rains, so we can go off-road a little bit. We are now deep on Arethusa, everybody. Oh, he's running, I'm afraid. We'll just get a quick view. Oh, there he goes. He's not very happy. Like I say, they're just highly threatened. There he is. Isn't he lovely? See the way he moves? and they look so completely like they are slow and unwieldy and unagile and galumphing, but actually they move at an astonishing speed. Oh no, he's going to hide from us. I'm afraid I don't want to pressure him. Isn't that wonderful? That's really quite special. Nice to see their sort of dark grey colours juxtaposed against this beautiful green drainage line. Hello, Kylie. You want to know if I have ever seen a hippo on foot? Yes, I have. And thankfully, the hippo did not see me. So, in fact, I was walking along on a sunny morning once. I was taking a journalist for a walk and a lady I was seeing at the time. And we went walking along at Londolozi and we were having a wonderful walk in the sort of early morning light. It was bright sunshine, middle of summer, so the heat was starting to build. And I saw a grey shape in the bush, quite far away from us, than the other side of the drainage line that we were walking along. So there was no danger. And I immediately assumed it was a rhino, simply because hippos are not out in the day normally. But it was a hippo going back to whatever piece of water he thought that he was best suited to. And yep, he didn't see us. We trailed him on the other side of the drainage line for a little while, and then we kind of moved off and left him. But yeah, I think I've seen a hippo once or twice more on foot, but very seldom have they ever seen me. And that's a really good thing. So what we're going to do is head to the very north of Arethusa now and then head down the eastern boundary of Arethusa. Rochelle, you're in London and you want to know if hippos can run faster than people. Rochelle, a hippopotamus, at least there's very little out here that can't run faster than a human being. A hippopotamus will probably reach a speed of about 45 to 50 kilometers per hour. Now, if you're Usain Bolt, and you are not, you are Rochelle, then you can probably run at a consistent speed of about 38 to 40 kilometers an hour. So you can probably run, if you're pretty fit and pretty quick, you can probably run at about 32 if you're really fast. And so we are at least sort of 15 to 20 kilometers an hour slower than a hippopotamus. Now, elephants will run at about 60. And even a little tree squirrel will be faster than we are. The things you cannot run here would be a leopard tortoise, obviously, a millipede, and perhaps a giant land snail. But other than that, you're really going to struggle to beat something out here. Even a guinea fowl, the humble guinea fowl, can run the 400 meters in faster than the world record of 43 seconds. So that is quite something. Let's go back to the leopards.
Right, number 9 in the last, I would say, 30 or so minutes. Oh, she's cross. So unhappy with him. Shame. Poor girl. Definitely not terribly impressed. Now, I've had the most thrilling moment while you were with James, where she walked right next to the vehicle. It's the closest I've ever been to Tundi. And she stopped and she looked at Jandra and myself, and then she moved past quite happily because she'd chosen to approach us. But I was struck by how incredibly tiny she is. I think she might even be smaller than Shadow. She really is a tiny little female. Really beautiful, dark, dark in color. Look, I mean, she's also covered in mud from where she's chosen to lie, which makes her darker. But she really is a beautiful cat. Oh. And you can't see her beautiful face because I've put Jandra in the worst spot. Here we go. That's fine for now because she's going to get up and follow Tingana again. Now, Anne, you were wondering, just because we've been watching them be particularly enthusiastic this afternoon. There she goes. And you were wondering how long they've been mating for, and if I could comment on their current level of activity, since it is towards the end of their estrus cycle. Now, as far as I know, they've started mating 5 days ago. Mm-hmm. So it is very much towards the end. I think the reason that they are mating as frequently now is, first of all, I don't think every initiated mating here is successful. I don't think it's always resulting in full penetration, but I think it's also because she's cold. I mean, it's cold, so they don't need to worry about wasting body or warming themselves up too much and getting too hot. Guys, we are going to have to leave the sighting at some point. I'm trying to find a good position. Because there are other vehicles that would like to come and join, and of course we've had a good 45 minutes of them all to ourselves, which has been an absolute pleasure.
Thanks so much, Kunai. I'll let you know when I'm around. I'm still there on Ganymede, Blowing in area.
I might need to just follow behind Taxon for now. Andrew, I will pull out when you get here.
That's fine.
Copy that. Where have they gone to? They've already crossed past this little pan. It's such a beautiful spot here. Anne, I was in the middle of answering you. I think it's because it's cold that they are mating so frequently. And I think that they're going to be done very, very soon. I mean, usually with the big cats, you get a drop-off towards the end where they stop mating. There's a decrease in frequency of the mating. And I really honestly think that perhaps it's just the fact that it's not too hot. So they've got a little bit more energy to devote to such energy. They're mating again. Can you believe it? Sorry, Jandre, I have a buffalo thorn there. I know it's not the clearest view. That was number 10. 10 in 30 minutes. Or 40 minutes, maybe. And they definitely, usually you see them mate about once every 15, 20 minutes. They've definitely been far more enthusiastic this afternoon. And he is flopped down there. Okay. Now, as you can see, it's quite a tricky position in terms of getting a view of them. And there are two vehicles that I've allowed Taxon and Aubrey to just go ahead of me, so because their guests haven't had a clear view yet. We will have to take our position at the back. It might mean we have to look through some leaves, but that's okay. We've had some incredible visuals so far. Watch out. Tammy, who's watching in Indiana, the reason I'm giggling a little bit is because Tammy would like to know, and I'm just going to unfortunately present you with that view for now. Not terribly clear. Can you see her from there, Jandre? Sort of. Not really. Not so much. Tammy was wondering what on earth Tingana is going to do with all his time when the ladies all have cubs. Will he be glad for their lack of attention, or will he go off in search of other females? And the answer, Tammy, is I somehow feel as though he might be somewhat relieved. But there will be other females in the area to mate with. Tingana does have quite a large territory. So whilst he won't necessarily go looking for females to mate with on his boundary patrols, if he does encounter a female in Estrus, he will stop and spend a little bit of time with her. I mean, I think I'm probably anthropomorphizing it a little bit. You know, it's instinct that plays a role. He doesn't know whether he's glad or sad that the ladies have found him, but it is really hilarious to watch because you can just see his disgust when they approach him. He's just so put upon and not enjoying anything at all. And the way that he was walking earlier suggests to me that he's also feeling quite sore. This, I'm afraid, is our visual. This is as good as it's going to get for now. We'll just have to be patient and wait for them to move again. There's a leopard. There are two leopards there. Believe it or not, and I cannot, unfortunately. Oh, I can. I can get you a bit of a view. She is hiding. If I go forward a bit, there we go. There. There's a leopard there. Here we go again for the 11th time. Somewhere. We might have to just listen this time around. Question about Tingana. Over the last few months, we have seen Tingana mate with Kwetile, then Shadow, then Karula, then Shadow again, then Karula again, then Tundi, and then Tundi, and then Tundi. And he basically hasn't gone for any extended period of time without a break. He obviously, as the dominant male leopard in this area, his genes are in much demand. The ladies all go looking for him. He doesn't have to go looking for them. But Lael, you were wondering about if, for example, two females were in estrus at the same time, would they fight for the attention of the male? And no, probably not. I have heard reports of sightings with a male mating with two females at the same time. I've also heard a report of two males mating with one female at the same time as well, without fighting each other, which is interesting, because that is the sort of situation that you'd expect the leopards to really come into conflict over. Passing on your genes is an intrinsic instinct within all of the animal species out here, and wanting to be the one that does it rather than allowing another male or another female to do so is a different story. So no, probably not. The females probably wouldn't fight, at least in this area. I think because Tundi and Shadow and Karula are all related, there might be some growling. They'll certainly have very stern words with each other. Perhaps even Karula might blow another spit bubble, as she did the last time she was seen with Shadow. It was highly entertaining, not terribly dignified behavior for the Queen of Juma, but she did manage to blow an incredible bubble of spit. So they might growl at each other, grrr, a little bit, and then the male will and take turns to mate with the male. The fact that two males have been seen mating with one female is a situation that I find more extraordinary. You might even find, while we've been sitting here, that Karula is somewhere here, somewhere in this facility. It's very common because Tundi's been brought into the center of her territory by Tingana. It's very common for that particular female to go and watch what's happening. All right, this is actually going to be our last few moments with them. Andrew, you can make your way as soon as I've got your audio. I'll pull out. We're on the northern side of that pan, close to the Shabam Road junction with Treehouse Dam Road.
Okay, thanks so much. I'll be making my approach.
Copy. Okay. Well, in the time that we've spent with them, we've seen them mate 11 times, or at least seen them mate 9 times and heard the 2 other times. It's been quite an extraordinary way to spend an afternoon. Thank you, girl and boy, for allowing us the privilege of spending a bit of time with you. I'm going to head out, let Andrew come into the sighting in the meantime, and let's find out what James is up to.
Look. There, everybody, is a little purply flower called Indigophora. And I have stopped to show it to you because it is pretty, A, and B, you can see the silvery sheen of water on the grass behind it. And that has been falling all day long. just little bits of water coming out of the sky in sort of waves of drizzle. If you can imagine those thick sort of Scotch mists blowing in off the sea in waves, that's basically what we've had today. So it hasn't rained for the last little while. I'm sure it will again during the course of the afternoon. But the grass is just holding a beautiful little example of what looks like mercury there. Next to some Indigophora flowers. I don't know what exactly which species of Indigophora they are. Anyway, that doesn't matter. They're still just as pretty. So our plan now is to head south again. We're now at the far northeastern corner of our traversing on Arethusa, and we're going to go south. We know that Shadow has been up and down in this area with her youngsters. We certainly, well, we have an idea where the youngsters are, but we're not going to go anywhere near that. We're just going to maybe see if Shadow isn't on the hunt, say hello to her, give her our fondest regards, and then we'll press on. But it will be very nice to see her. We'll probably try and view those cubs again, well, not again, for the first time, in about 4 weeks. They are now about 4 weeks old. And of course, Tundi and Tingana are quite likely to have some more cubs fairly soon, if their enthusiasm for each other is anything to go by. Otherwise, we haven't found a great deal here on Arethusa. It has been fairly quiet and blustery, as I suspected it would. And I can't tell you, I mean, I know when I started off the drive, I was sitting under that bush and sort of, I'm sure some of you thought I wasn't being serious, but I really was being very serious. It's a really nice place to be. In the base of these trees, underneath the leaves, you're sheltered from the wind, you're sheltered from the odd little squall that comes through. And that's, I think, what most of the animals are doing around here right now. We saw some impala and one woodpecker since we left you. And I'm afraid that's been about it. And that's pretty normal. Oh, Christy, hello, you're on Twitter. And you'd like to see a cheetah on drive. Well, Christy, I also would love to see a cheetah on drive. Brian, would you like to see a cheetah?
I'd love to see one.
We'd all like to see a cheetah. Christy, it's unlikely. I'll tell you why it's unlikely. But and if you keep watching in the next week or two, it might become slightly more likely. So you can see the landscape around us is quite thick. There is quite a lot of trees. And remember, a cheetah is what we call a courser. They like to hunt on flat, open ground because they run at 60 miles an hour, 100 kilometers an hour. And I mean, you can imagine trying to run through here at 60 miles an hour. You'd either get a very nasty headache, or in some cases, cheetah have been known to disembowel themselves by mistake. They run so fast over a stump and they actually slice open their innards and disembowel themselves. So this is not ideal habitat for a cheetah. But in the next 2 or 3 weeks, we will be driving on Cheetah Plains, which is named for the southern section of the reserve there that is made of, well, it's slightly more open because the geology is different. It's called gabbro. The underlying geology here is called granite, and there it's gabbro, and that makes a lot more grassland than it does the granite, which tends to make this kind of broadleaf Cambrian woodland, which is really not ideal cheetah habitat. So with any luck, in the next week or two, or maybe three, we'll be seeing a few more cheetah on drive. So just to give you a progress report on that, the tower went up today at Cheetah Plains. Not sure why that's there. Oh, yes, I am. And that means that the technical stuff is happening, but there will be an inevitable phase where when we switch on, it's highly likely that there'll be things that need to be adjusted and fixed. So while we could possibly be live from there by as early as next week, I think there are going to be a few things to sort out before that becomes a reality. But very exciting times. We go from 1,500 hectares to 2,100 hectares, which is 4,000 acres, to about, well, just under 6,000, which is really nice. But otherwise, things on the animal front out here, deathly quiet. Ryan, do you see any animals?
No.
No.
Nothing. Not even birds.
Not even birds. Hello, Annie and Dave. We want to talk about our other coursing predator out here. That is the African wild dog, or the painted wolf of Africa. Very beautiful, magnificent animal. Certainly one of my all-time favorites, if not my favorite. And you want to know, do they have a den? And what would bring them to Juma or Arethusa? Well, first question, do they have a den? Not a permanent one, no. Only when they have just had puppies, and those puppies spend about 2 to 3 months denning. Then the den will normally be in a termite mound. Howling gale coming through now. They'll normally be in a termite mound, and they'll spend about, so yeah, like I say, 2 or 3 months, and then the pups will start to move with the pack, and they won't be stashed in the den anymore. What would bring them here would be the need for food or hunting, and their movements do tend to be fairly random. Sorry, just making my way around this slightly difficult area. There's a Christian Franklin stop bird. No, even the Franklins don't want to stop for us. So their movements are pretty random, and they may or may not come back here, you know, at various times, Dave and Annie. And that's how, I mean, we'd normally see them. What normally happens, Annie and Dave, is that they'll come through, say, for 2 weeks at a time, and then they'll disappear again for up to 2 or 3 months at a time, and they'll come back again. We do know that the pack that we normally see came south onto, or came south from the Manuleti briefly onto Biffle's Hoek recently, and then they seem to go back north again. So we haven't seen the wild dogs actually for some time now, so we're due a visit. And they'll start to mate now also. Their gestation period is about 70 days, and they like to give birth in the middle of winter. So as we head to, well, I mean, May is probably a more reasonable time for them to mate, but some of the packs will mate now, and they'll give birth sometime in the winter. Which may seem like an odd time for an animal to give birth, given that there aren't a lot of little baby things to eat around. But if you're a coursing predator, like a cheetah or a wild dog, the winter is a good time because there are no leaves on the trees. And so everything is clear, and it's much easier to chase your prey through the bush than it is at a time like this. And that's why they give birth almost always in the middle of the winter. Thank you, Annie and Dave. Gosh, Brian, it is fairly barren out here. Maybe we'll be able to see a terrapin, Brian. Maybe in the pan there'll be a terrapin, some form of heartbeat and life. No, even that is barren. Monique, you're in London, you want to know about the tower at Cheetah Plains, and is it a tower or is it a balloon? Well, in theory, it could have been a balloon, Monique, but it isn't a balloon. We haven't managed to quite make that work yet. I say we. I mean the technical department, because I'm not nearly clever enough to be in the technical department. They are trying, for everybody else who perhaps doesn't know what Monique's talking about, there was a balloon experiment. We're still doing a balloon experiment where we send, instead of putting the repeater on the end of a fairly expensive tower, you put it on a balloon and send it into the air. We haven't managed to make that work just yet. But this is going to be a tower. Hello, Eric Moore, Virginia Beach, Virginia. Eric, you want to know, we've got lots of standing water around at the moment, and will some of the wading birds and waterfowl come back or inundate the area because of this? Interestingly, probably not, Eric, and that's because most of the wading birds, of course, are migratory, and that means that most of them have headed north already for the wintertime, our wintertime, your summertime, or the most of the waders' case is the Palearctic summertime, so up into Eurasia. And so despite the fact that we do have standing water here, it might delay the departure of a few of the wading birds, but certainly I don't think it's going to attract anything back that would otherwise have gone away. I suppose you might get a few sort of nomadic wading species, and there aren't that many around. I mean, a few nomadic ducks perhaps might come and spend a bit of time here when they wouldn't normally. Things like a fulvous duck. But no, I don't think that they're going to attract a whole lot of wading birds this time of year. Certainly, if we'd had early rains, then I think we would have had far more waders than we did at this time, at, you know, sort of earlier in the season. Susan, I love this question. I've been asked once or twice before. And it's not noticeable, but I do think it happens. And you want to know, do the animals here get thicker winter coats like yours do in Michigan? Susan, the answer is yes, probably. I'm not sure how thick they get, but if you look at an impala in the middle of July, they certainly do appear to be a little more furry than they are at this time of the year. But remember, the temperature variation that we get here is nothing like as wide as it is in a place like Michigan. So I don't know what your minimum temperature is in winter, but probably close to minus 20 degrees Celsius, maybe minus 10 or minus 15. Here, it's 4 degrees Celsius, which is about 45 degrees Fahrenheit. So that's, you know, that's not that cold. And then in the middle of the day, it goes all the way up to sort of 23, 24, which is, I mean, that's into the 70s Fahrenheit. So that's pretty good temperatures. Whereas in Michigan, of course, you probably drop to minus 15 on really cold days and don't get up above 3 degrees Celsius. And so the animals there and the animals in all of the northern reaches of the northern hemisphere have to grow these thick winter coats, otherwise they'd freeze to death. But that just isn't the case out here. And that is a lovely question, because I'm often amused by some of the pictures I see of animals from the northern hemisphere in their winter coats. It is very amusing indeed. The quintessential one being the Hillen Coo of northern Scotland, which develops a quite fantastic array of long, very warm hair for the Highland or the Scottish Highland winter. Just a termite mound through there, Brian. Oh, look, Brian, there's a bird. Quickly, film it before it flies. Might be the last thing we see. Virtual starling, everybody. There we go.
Splendid sight.
Splendid, yes. I'm going to trouble you just once more, Brian, to show us how fast the clouds are moving, if you don't mind. But you can see that there is a mighty wind blowing up there. And the clouds are moving at a great speed, and you can perhaps hear the wind now moving through the silver clusterleaf orchard off in front of where your picture is. Those trees just below your picture there are waving in this southeast wind. Barney's back quickly. Two of them, Brian. Look at that, everybody, a spectacular sighting of Virchel's starlings. All right, Deborah Armchair Trapper, you want to know about the rollers, the bee eaters, and the kingfishers, and which ones of them are resident and which ones of them go away for the winter. Well, in terms of the kingfishers, the most obvious one that disappears, of course, is the woodland kingfisher. Its call is no longer heard, chorusing throughout the bush, throughout all times of the day and night, which initially is quite a mercy. Well, I will get back to your question, Deborah. Here are the two plovers, or lapwings, that we went past earlier, and their nest. We're just going to drive straight past this time. Let's see if you can spot it. Oh! Brian, you all right?
Yeah, all right. Slightly traumatized.
Brian was traumatized. They're attacked by a very angry crowned lapwing. Anyway, Deborah, so we don't get the woodland kingfisher here in the summertime. The grey hooded also goes away, as does the pygmy. The pygmy kingfisher is also migratory. So those three disappear. So potentially in the winter you can see the brown hooded. I haven't seen a striped here, which I think is unusual. They also migrate, but well, I haven't seen one at Juma. I used to see them quite a lot in the south of the Sabi Sands. So you can see woodland, you can see, you can see brown hooded, pied, and potentially giant as well here during the course of the winter, and also malachite if you've got enough water. But I don't think we're going to see those. Then the bee eaters, we get four species here, of course. I haven't brought my book with me, I'm afraid. Let me stop it. I've got them on my phone, simply because of the rain, and I don't want my book to get inundated. But I'll show you quickly, for those of you who don't know, otherwise it's going to be extremely boring. The bee eaters are beautiful birds, and they've got lots of lovely colours. There we go, Brian. And we get four species here, two of them on this particular page, and both of these two are resident. The white-fronted is there, and that one's resident. Let's just double-tap him. Tap, tap. There, beautiful picture of the white-fronted bee-eater. He hangs around for the winter time. There's a photograph of him. And then if we go across, we might go straight to the little bee-eater. That is the other resident species that we get here, the little bee-eater. Then we have two that are migratory, also very beautifully coloured. We've got the European, that's it there. It also used to be called the golden-backed bee-eater, which you can, and you can see why. It's because it has a what, Brian?
A golden back.
Correct, golden back. Very obviously seen there. And then, of course, we have the southern... we don't have that one. We've got the southern carmine bee-eater, and they also migrate. But they're intra-African migrants, so they migrate into northern parts of Africa, and unlike the European, which, of course, goes back to Europe. They're just the most stunning colours. Look at that. Isn't that lovely? So those are the bee-eaters that migrate. And then the other one you wanted to know about was the rollers. Now, the rollers, they don't migrate, any of them, I don't believe, except the European, of course. Let me quickly show you them, just in the absence of any kind of large biting predator, which might arrest our attention. There are all the rollers, and there's the European, and he's the only one, as far as I'm aware, that migrates. Beautiful. He's actually not quite as beautiful as that picture. That's a better picture of him. He's a fairly dull-coloured blue bird. Yes, that's a much more accurate representation of him. And he goes back to Europe. That's been doctored, that photograph. He has got quite bright wings, I suppose. And then the most common colourful bird of the wintertime is, of course, the lilac-breasted roller, who is magnificent. There he is there. And it's so wonderful to have such a common, or such a colourful bird being so common. That's him. And then we also get a purple roller here. We'll just see if that's him. That's the racket-tailed, which we don't get here. There's the purple roller. We get him too, and he is resident. So, Deborah Armchair Traveller, I hope that tells you all you need to know about the rollers, kingfishers, and bee-eaters. The purple roller, yes, definitely much more magnificent in pencil crayon than he is in photographs. Right, let us go across to Jamie. She's got some common antelope not seeking shelter in the leaves, and we will continue south down this road.
A common antelope, but an unusual one in one regard, and that of course is the fact that this impala is missing half of his horns. We're missing one horn. And so he only has one sticking up out of the top of his head. This is not Nelson, our famous one-horned, one-eyed male impala. This is a different one-horned impala. He's got both eyes intact, so he's got one up on Mr. Nelson. There you can see. And off he goes. I'm glad he stuck around. He's very patient considering how incredibly windy this is. I mean, the trees are all bending over as this wind howls in from the south, and it's making all of the animals terribly unsettled. Sure. And it's particularly pronounced in this area because there's so many silver clusterleaf trees, and the underside of a lot of the bush willow leaves are also quite silvery. So we've sort of got this incredible colour shift that's happening as the wind blows the trees. Now, just as James sent you across to my side, my earpiece appears to be playing up a little bit, so I'm just going to test it. Okay, it seems to be working fine. There we go. It seems to be all sorted for now. Hopefully it stays that way. So it's very common to see, not very common, but it is fairly common to see impala with a broken horns. Now, having just come from a summer that was about easily most days over 40 degrees, well into the hundreds Fahrenheit every single day, I am at this point feeling positively hypothermic with this wind biting through our clothes. I'm not sure exactly what the temperature is at the moment. It's probably in the low 60s Fahrenheit, so not really all that cold. I think we've just been spoiled in terms of a temperature. And Arbeard, you were wondering, in terms of the animals' responses to these kinds of cold snaps, would the animals in Kruger know to move north if there's a cold snap in the south or vice versa? Or is it a moot point just because we don't really get cold snaps? We do get cold snaps. The north tends to be a little bit warmer than the southern part of the Kruger, but that's generally, there's not much in the way in terms of difference between the different parts and temperatures, not enough to initiate a movement of animals. The only thing that will really get them moving from north to south or around the Kruger will be access to food and access to water. That will be what causes the larger migrations. It won't be initiated by temperature. In South Africa, our winters are, especially in the low veld, the high veld less so, the high veld around Johannesburg, that's at a much higher altitude. And those winters, our winters do get very cold, it gets very frosty. But out here in the low veld, you hardly ever see frost, you certainly never see snow. And it's not really a drop in temperature that is sufficient to require animals to move about because of it. We're far more, the animals out here are far more concerned with access to water and the dry versus the wet season. Stronger on the end of the branch here, Jandre, has caught something, and I think it is a butterfly. Does that look like a butterfly? I can't quite tell.
African migrant, I think.
Yeah, it does look like an African migrant butterfly, and they just actually had a little bit of a fight over it. That sort of attracted my attention. I could just hear them screeching at each other. Oh, gulp, 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 gone. Just the tip of the wing sticking out. This is a lovely little bird that we see all year around in this particular area. But of course, I know that Rick James was chatting a bit about the migration patterns of the different birds. And Brian, who's watching in Minnesota, you were wondering what the furthest migratory species is. Sorry, hold on 1 second. Somebody's just trying to get hold of me. I'll get back to you in a moment, Brian. Standing by.
Yeah, you're welcome to make your way back if you want to.
Okay, copy that. Thank you. Are they still same position?
Positive.
Thanks, Dax. On my way. Should we go back to mating leopards? I feel as though we should go back to mating leopards. Nobody else wants to go into that sighting. So we can go back and have it all to ourselves. And I'm going to make that decision. Sorry, Brian, I promise I will get back to you. I'm going to make that decision because they're so mobile. This weather is so cool and cloudy that they could get up and move 20 feet into that block and we wouldn't be able to find them again when we did want to return to them tonight. So that is my plan. Let's go back to towards the mating leopards and rejoin that sighting so that they don't disappear on us. So, Brian, longest migration. Look, steppe eagles, I'm trying to think. I don't know that this is exactly the longest. It is one of the longest. Will be steppe eagles migrating back up towards Russia. I'm trying to think what else would be considered. I mean, the swallows and the barn swallows, or European swallows as they are now known, do move incredibly large distances. So they go from South Africa all the way up into the UK and northern reaches of Europe. So that's one such migration. I'm trying to think if there's anything else. We don't really get the enormous bat migrations that countries further to the north of Africa do. I'm trying to think which bird would be the absolute furthest migratory bird. I'm pretty sure that the steppe eagle is quite far up there. The white storks also up towards Germany, sometimes Croatia, all the way through Europe. Most of our migratory species either migrate in from Europe or Russia, or they migrate towards the northern and central parts of Africa. That's, for example, the kingfishers or the Warburg's eagles, which is a slightly smaller distance. Oh, so chilly. This wind. Ah. So I was starting, I was busy focusing on some berries, but he flew away as I stopped. This wind definitely... This wind definitely unsettles all of the animals in this area. They really, really don't like it. Now, I must admit, the rain this morning in the middle of the day did take me considerably by surprise. I thought we were done with rain for the rest of our dry season, or pretty much done with rain. However, it did rain. I wouldn't call it heavily, but it certainly rained rather than just drizzled. And Kylie, you were wondering if we're going likely to have any more heavy rain. I don't think so. But I have to be completely honest, Kylie, my weather predictions this year have been completely off. Every time I have tried to make a prediction, it has gone in the opposite direction. If I've said it's not going to rain, it rains. If I don't have my rain covers on, it rains. When I do have my rain covers on, it doesn't rain. So, Kylie, I don't think if we do get any more rain over the next few days, it will be in little fits and starts of drizzle. Maybe that might, if we're lucky, might reach up to about 2 millimeters. While I make my way back towards the leopard sighting, see if I can't find you a nice view, why don't you jump on the back of the vehicle with James.
Now, we had a question come through about the difference between a pan and a pond and a dam. Catherine, it was from you. This, Catherine, is a pan. And a pan is a natural depression in the land that has normally been formed by wallowing animals. This has been formed by warthogs initially. Is that a...
Oh, nothing.
A piece of mud?
Yeah.
Dung?
Yeah.
Dung. Been formed by warthogs and then buffalo and then elephants. And all sorts of things have come and wallowed around here. So this is called a pan. And they form in an area where there's lots of clay in the soil. And so when the hole forms and the rain comes, it holds water. And that's what's called a pan. I guess it would be the same as a pond, I imagine. We just don't use the term pond here. I'm not sure why. I'm not sure what the etymology of the word pond is or the etymology of the word pan. But they're the same kind of thing. A dam, of course, is completely distinct because it is man-made. A dam is a man-made wall or structure across a drainage line or stream or river that then stops the flow of the water initially, and that's how a dam is formed. And we've got a number of dams on this reserve, 1, 2, 3 that hold water. And then if you go to Biffles Hook, well, there are probably about 7 or 8 dams on Biffles Hook, a couple on Arethusa, and we build them out here mainly to hold water for the animals. This is a fairly, what should we say, controversial ecological practice, because it means that there's often water around when there wouldn't naturally be water around. Anyway, Catherine, thank you for that. That is the difference. Despite the foulness of the weather, there is still a lovely smell in the air. And every so often I get a very sort of, there's a very sweet scent to the air. And I don't know why, but it smells like, when I, there, you smell that? Mm-hmm. I don't know what it is, but it smells precisely like it did when I was in Cornwall in England last year, running along the hedgerows in amongst the blackberries. And I don't know what the smell is. Let's have a quick look. There are a couple of flowers around here. I'm just going to turn that down because it's a bit noise in my ear. Let me get out here. Let's see. We'll smell all the different kinds of flowers. So, we have what looks like a species of Waltheria here. It might be that, Brian, if it's a, it's a very kind of... if you get far enough away from that, it might smell like that. That's got quite a sweet smell.
Maybe.
This has got a much stronger smell when you smell it. It's got sort of a sweet herby type of a smell, wouldn't you say, Brian? Mm. Yeah, sweet herby. Could be this, actually, as because it's in large group... they cover quite large areas, and it could be this as we drive through. Then there is Justicia flava, this beautiful yellow flower. Ooh. I don't think that has any scent at all. Try that, Brian. Of course, for Brian and I to be doing this, we are taking our lives in our hands for you, of course, because we both suffer from fairly nasty allergies.
Not that one.
I don't think it's this one. I think it's this. And then one more this side. Now, Brent Leo Swift swears blind that this Senna petisiana, or monkey pod, smells nice. Now, the leaves smell horrible. The smells, the leaves sort of smell, well, what do they smell like? They smell, I don't know, they just smell like sort of oil, nasty oil. And he says they these smell nice. And I don't get any scent from them at all.
I don't know, I can smell them.
Can you?
Yeah.
Is that what it is?
No.
No. I think it's these.
It is very subtle. There is one more flower.
Is there?
Yeah.
What is it? Ah. The wild foxglove.
Mmm.
And I don't think these smell either. Ugh. It actually smells like kind of really pungent chocolate.
Yeah, sure.
Eh?
Wow.
Like pungent chocolate.
Super cocoa chocolate.
Yes, super cocoa chocolate, exactly.
That's incredible.
What if, maybe it's that. Maybe it's that in very subtle, that at a distance.
That chocolate, yeah, maybe.
That's what it is. It is, it's these.
Mm.
It's this at a distance. There we go. Sort of, so imagine driving through a field of chocolate, if you like, and the chocolate giving up a gentle smell, and because there's so much of it all around the place, it smells quite subtle, but when you put it in your face, it's very powerful. Good. It's nice. Glad we discovered that. I've never smelt it.